Changing My Mind by Margaret Trudeau. Narrated by Maureen McAdams. Dedication. To my brave daughter, Alicia Mary Rose Kemper, and all the daughters of mothers who struggle with a mental illness. Chapter 1. The Brawling SINCLAIRS. My grandmother once told me when I was very young, "Margaret, you're one of the more delicate flowers in the garden, but you're also a perennial." Only later did I understand that she was remarking on how fragile I was, and yet how durable. A perennial is an eternal flower, one that keeps coming back year after year. Roberts Creek, British Columbia, August 1958. Fish, salmon in particular, brought the SINCLAIRS from Scotland to Canada in 1911. My paternal grandfather, James SINCLAIR, was born in Wick, in the high north of Scotland, and grew up farther south in Banffshire, historically a major supplier of salmon to Europe. The nearby River Deveron is still well known among fly fishers for its sizable catches of salmon, sea trout, and brown trout. My grandfather had been caught poaching salmon from that same river, which was then known as the Laird's River. The game warden happened to be a friend, and he was understanding but firm. "Jimmy," he warned, "if I catch you again, you'll have to go to jail." "If I can a fish," James SINCLAIR replied, famously in family lore, "I can a live." He was a schoolteacher in the town of Grange, but he had struggled to feed his family on his meager wages, and so he went home, pulled out all his maps, and decided to seek his fortune and new fishing grounds in the British colonies. British Columbia, with all its spawning rivers, its many lakes and long ocean coast, and some of the biggest salmon in the world, beckoned. He never regretted the move. My grandfather prospered in Vancouver, where he enjoyed a stellar and path-breaking career helping to establish the area's first vocational school, which still exists, Vancouver Technical Secondary School. He remained a passionate fisherman. He saved up enough money to buy a cottage on the Seychelles Peninsula, and he would spend hours on the porch of his boathouse making spoons and lures for the salmon he planned to catch. Some of my Scottish relatives were a little on the dour side, but not my grandfather. He was fun. I remember him playing the Pied Piper in his rambling old house during parties and at Christmas, leading the shrieking grandkids up and down the stairs as he played the harmonica. My paternal grandmother was Betsy Ross, another northern Scot who was as tough as she was sweet. She ran a tight ship. They had a beautiful plum tree in the garden, and Grandma made plum jam from the fruit. She wasn't the gardener that my other grandmother was, but she did grow some things, as any sensible Scot would. James George SINCLAIR, the son of James and Betsy, was just 2 when the family left Scotland. Dad inherited his father's burr and retained it all his life. The accent especially came out when he was telling stories. And he loved to tell stories. He was also a very good mimic. He was a smart man, my father. He studied engineering at the University of British Columbia and was awarded a Rhodes Scholarship to study mathematics at Oxford University. He sent home wonderful letters describing how, as a Rhodes Scholar, he had been invited to Lady Astor's for lunch on a Sunday. A classically prudent Scot, he knew it would tax the family budget, but it seemed important to him to own a well-cut, well-made suit, a navy blue blazer with gold buttons. Later, my father studied mathematical physics at Princeton and took up his father's profession, teaching, in his case, at a Vancouver high school. One of his brightest students was Kathleen Bernard, and in 1940, when he was 31 and she was just 19, they got married. Looking back at this May-December marriage, I wonder if it paved the way for my own wedding to a man who was 2 years older than my mother. My father was a big, imposing fellow, 6 feet 2 inches tall. Jimmy SINCLAIR was gruff on the outside, but he was also a good man, fair and sweet. and he was stern with my sisters and me only when we dared cross our mother or disrespected her. Then came the wrath of God. He doted on my mother and loved her so much. I never heard a cross word between them. Such total harmony was little use as a role model for my own marriage. I never heard my parents fight and did not know that it was possible for a wife to quarrel or argue with her husband. Suppression of anger, I believed, was how to cope. My father, for all his intelligence, was also a simple man with simple tastes. He would come down to breakfast wearing a green business suit, a blue tie, and one sock colored navy, the other brown. "Oh, Daddy, look at you," my sisters would all yell, imploring him to wear clothes that matched. He didn't care. He always said, "I dress to keep warm and I eat to fuel my body." Years later, he dined one Christmas with Pierre and me at 24 Sussex Drive, where staff had opened a Chateau Latour from the 1940s, an extraordinary bottle of wine, to honor his presence. "Don't waste the good stuff on me," he told them, and asked for some cooking wine from the kitchen. In his political thinking, he was a left-leaning liberal. He was born into the Presbyterian Church, but never attended services. "Too harsh," he said, of that brand of Protestantism. My mother was outstandingly beautiful. Tall, with hazel eyes and raven hair, Kathleen had the finest, most beautiful skin, which turned bronze in the sun, thanks to the Malaysian blood that coursed through her. Her great-great-great-great-grandfather, William Farquhar, was a Scottish-born British officer in the East India Company who played a pivotal role in the founding of Singapore in the early 19th century. After the British lost both Java and the tiny Malaysian Sultanate of Malacca to the Dutch, General Farquhar set out to find a new port, and together with Sir Stamford Raffles, Lieutenant Governor of Java, founded Singapore. But the two men had a falling out over the way Singapore was to be settled. Sir Stamford abhorred gambling, cockfighting, and the notion of indentured servants, and he wanted the waterfront preserved for government buildings and residences. The more easygoing Farquhar, who spoke Malaccan and who had great respect for the Malaysian culture, knew that local people weren't about to abandon all their bad habits overnight, and he reserved the waterfront for the merchants. When Raffles returned after several years away and saw that his orders had been ignored, he dismissed Farquhar. On the day William left, in 1823, the roads were so densely packed with people wanting to say goodbye that it took him 3 hours to reach his boat. He left behind Antoinette Clement, his companion of some 25 years, and their 5 children settled on a rubber plantation. There was no thought of her joining him. She would have found the Scottish climate and the imperious thinking of the day equally unwelcoming. Once back in Scotland, William Farquhar married a new wife. While still in Singapore, between 1819 and 1823, my ancestor commissioned various Chinese artists to illustrate local plants, mammals, birds, fish, and insects found in Malacca and Singapore. Some 477 watercolors were completed, and several copies of the original paintings now hang on the walls of my Montreal condominium. My mother then could trace her line back to a country wife, since Antoinette was the daughter of a French officer and a Malaysian woman. In colonies all over the world, men of various empires took up with local women, in the way that soldiers, explorers, and fur trade managers in Canada took First Nations women as wives. A bit of brown, they were sometimes called. Several years ago, the CBC TV genealogy series, Who Do You Think You Are?, followed me to Singapore, where I probed my own roots. It turns out that William Farquhar and Antoinette Clement's eldest daughter, Esther, married a British officer named Francis James Bernard. But Francis did exactly what his father had done. In 1827, he left Singapore on a trading ship, leaving behind Esther and their 5 children. She died there, destitute, at the age of 41. No point in decrying such behavior. Blame the times. Esther's descendants found their way to Australia, from there to Manitoba, then to Penticton in the British Columbia interior, and finally to the West Coast. My mother was such an elegant and well-mannered person, with a deep well of tolerance and compassion. In hindsight, I think my mother's strengths and values helped me as a mother. Mom is 90 years old as I write these words, and she can look back on a hard life, though I doubt she would say that. Firm but kind by nature, she was a quiet, long-suffering soul, and mostly content with her lot. She had emerged from a solid working-class family, found a good and loving husband, raised 5 daughters. Nothing to complain about, and no use in any case. Still, she did suffer at times from depression, and she never got the treatment she needed. There is some evidence that genetics plays a role in bipolar disorder, but I'll never know what role that played in my own illness. I know only that my mother was alone much of the time and worried much of the time. When my father went overseas for the war in 1940, he served in the Royal Canadian Air Force in North Africa, Malta, and Sicily until 1945, he left behind a pregnant wife. While her husband was off overseas, my mother and her sister, whose husband was likewise off fighting, moved in with their mother. Before leaving, my father was elected as the Liberal Member of Parliament for North Vancouver, a position he held until 1957, including a 7-year stint as Minister of Fisheries in Prime Minister Louis Saint Laurent's government, one that finally fell to John Diefenbaker's Tory wave in 1958. Imagine the pride of James Sr. when James Jr. was put in charge of fish. All through the 1950s, my father traveled widely, to Europe, Ceylon, the USSR, and China, on political matters. Even when he was home, he worked most evenings studying briefs or engaged in writing business. My mother was very much a single mother, often alone with her daughters on the coast while her husband worked in Ottawa, or shuffling the family between homes in Ontario and British Columbia. When they were apart, reconnecting involved either a 5-day train trip or 13 hours on a Vickers Viscount prop plane. In those days, the wives of politicians would travel mostly by train from Ottawa back to their homes in their husbands' constituencies. My mother would keep company with John Diefenbaker's first wife, Edna, and they became great friends. Edna and John lived in Prince Albert, Saskatchewan, so Mom had Edna's companionship that far and continued on to the coast. My father was a member of Parliament for 18 years in total, and only in 1952, when he became a cabinet minister, did we actually live in Ottawa. Because she married and had children so early in life, my mother's own education was limited. She did become a nurse, and my father used to joke that by marrying her, he had saved her from washing loggers' backs. Later, when her daughters went off to university and brought home interesting books, she joined a living room learning class, what we would now call a book club. Bridge and the company of good friends were two of my mother's passions. Mine was a happy childhood, but there was not a lot of touching in my family. That's simply how it was in those days among WASPs, white Anglo-Saxon Protestants. If I was hurt as a child, I could crawl into my mother's arms and be comforted. Sometimes I'd fake being hurt to get that comfort. Physical hurt was one thing, psychological hurt quite another. "Let's have a pot of tea," was sometimes my mother's response. Her own mother had cautioned against any excess of emotion. Our joys and sorrows were always to be measured. I was the fourth of the 5 Sinclair girls, the brawling Sinclairs, as my father used to call us. Each of us competed for my father's love and attention, and all of us adored our mother. There were all the jealousies you would expect to find among so many sisters. We did everything as a family. My father took pride in the racket and the standing of such a respectably large group, even if we were all girls. My eldest sister, Heather, who was 7 years older than me, mothered me, as is often the case in large families. Jan was next, the eldest of the middle three sisters, who were each just 15 months apart in age, making for a lot of sibling rivalry and conflict.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.